Hello everyone, I'm Rhianna Lilly-Smith from Technology Networks, and today I'm delighted to be joined by Dr. Prescott Woodruff from the University of California, San Francisco, to discuss their latest study published in the Journal of the American Medical Association, following participants with tobacco-related lung diseases that do not currently fit any existing tobacco-related disease criteria. So first of all, what led you to undertake this study, and how did previous research impact your decision?
Well, the reason to undertake this study is that I was seeing patients in our research clinic who had symptoms after smoking for many years. And when we did physiology testing of their lung function, they didn't have COPD. They didn't meet the criteria for COPD. And so I didn't know exactly what to tell them because they were telling me they were having problems, but I couldn't give them a diagnosis. And previous research in this area has shown that people who smoke can develop things like mucus-producing cells in the airway, even if they don't have COPD, and we had been part of that research. So we knew there was a rationale for them having a problem.
Okay, so could you please talk about the key methods you used and why?
Most of the methods we used were really traditional clinical research methods. We built a longitudinal cohort of smokers. We followed them over time. We asked whether they had symptoms using standardized questionnaires. There wasn't too much fancy about that part of it. We did do some additional physiology testing and CT scans using quantitative techniques that were rather new. And we analyzed their sputum using biochemical techniques. But the main methods were tried and true longitudinal cohort methods.
Okay, so what were your key findings, and was there an aspect of the data that particularly interested you?
Sure, the key findings were that among people who smoked for more than 20 years, one pack per day, that a large percentage of them, 50% of them in our cohort, had symptoms like cough, sputum, shortness of breath. And if they had symptoms, they also had activity limitations and exacerbations or flares of a respiratory disease, despite the fact that they didn't have low lung function and didn't qualify for the diagnosis of COPD. Those were the main findings. In the most recent paper, we also showed that this persists over many years and that they don't progress to COPD. There are people who have a condition that doesn't have a name currently, and that is distinct from COPD.
So what does your research inform us about tobacco-related lung diseases, and how do you hope it will impact the future of diagnostic criteria for these diseases?
Well, the main impact is that we've shown that a lot more people who smoked chronically, even if they quit, have problems that could be a disease or health condition and that are not do not fall under the category of COPD, so that problems after smoking with the respiratory system are more common than previously perceived. And we hope to influence the GOLD guidelines, the guidelines that tell doctors, based on the evidence, how to diagnose lung disease after smoking. We hope to influence them by getting a category in there for this condition.
Okay, so what's next for your research team, and do you have any further studies planned?
Sure. One of the plans is to follow up these people for another 5 years to see what their long-term outcome is. And then another of our plans is to do clinical trials to see if we can improve their symptoms. We've already done one, actually. It was published last year. And we showed that the routine bronchodilators that are used for COPD don't help the symptoms in this condition. But since we've shown that they also have problems with mucus production, we're hoping to try some new mucoactive drugs, drugs that affect pathological mucus, to see if they improve this condition.
Thank you. That was really interesting.
Thank you.
To make sure you never miss a story, subscribe to Breaking Science News, the daily newsletter by Technology Networks. Bye.